Good evening. At this last session we spent together, and today we're going to talk on Syria and the situation in Syria, a country, of course, where the Arab Spring has turned into a bloody civil war. And if we may think about what's going to happen there in the future, I have to admit that my guess is as good as yours. I have no idea. There are developments on the diplomatic front. There are, of course, also military developments. And on the diplomatic front, there is something very new the last days, a meeting of the Syrian opposition in Qatar that has maybe brought a new breakthrough on the diplomatic grounds. On the military level, I think that, and many observers think so, that Syria is in a stalemate. We find ourselves in a death road position where none of the two fighting factions can be superior to the other for the instant, at this moment. The news of on Syria is repetitive every day. We see the same saddening stories, the same saddening images of people being killed, people being abducted, firing, civilians being shot and killed. The last weekend we have seen an escalation in violence from another side, and it was that Syria fired grenades on the Golan Heights, but the Golan Heights that are occupied by Israel, and Israel retaliated with a strike on the Syrian army posts. Observers, of course, and international players fear that such an escalation this may lead to more escalation, and that other parties may get involved into a widening struggle. For example, Turkey, where also some skirmishes have happened between Syria and Turkey. For example, also Saudi Arabia, or Iraq, or Iran, or the Lebanese Hezbollah. And some prophets of doom in the press have already mentioned the possibility in the Arab world, and some journalists, the possibility of a third world war. I think that's maybe a little bit too dramatic, but an escalation in the region may lead to an aggravation of the war situation in the whole region, or parts of the whole region. But I think that the most actors, at least for the moment being, exert a lot of restraint in an escalation of violence. I mean between the states, among the states, between Syria, for example, and Turkey, between Syria and Israel. Let us look at a few facts about the country very quickly, and the geography of Syria. Syria is very central in the Middle East. As you can see, it's bordered to the north by Turkey, the east a very long borderline with Iraq, the south Jordan, and then the Golan Heights occupied by Israel, and Lebanon, the neighboring countries of Syria. Demographically, the population is constituted of about 22 million. There are different ethnic groups. A majority is Arabs, but there's also some 9% of Kurds in the northeast of the region, bordering here on Turkey, and Armenians. Also on the religious side, Syria shows a real mosaic of religions, religions of different origin. You have a majority of Sunnite Muslims, and the estimations are that they are between 65 or 70% of the population. You have diverse groups of Shiites, Shiite Muslims, not only the Twelver Shiites as we know them in Iran, but also the Alawis, of whom we're going to talk soon, Ismailis, and the Druze. Also, among the Christians, you find different denominations of mostly Eastern churches, Melkites, Maronites, Nestorians probably, but also Orthodox, Catholic, and Protestant. And so on the ethnic and religious level, you see that the population of Syria is very diversified. Syria is has always been a central state in the Middle or Near East, and also since already ancient times. It was a very ancient civilization that lived together with the pharaonic civilization, for example, in Egypt. Syrians say about themselves that the alphabet, for example, the first alphabet was made in Ugarit, in the so-called spike script. And also in the old later ancient world, it took a central place. Hellenism has had a great impact due to, of course, the neighboring countries of Greece, but also Alexandria. It was an important province in the Roman Empire. And in the late Roman Empire, there was a revolt in Palmyra, a Nabatees, so Arab civilization within Syria, pre-Islamic, that fought the Romans under the guidance of Queen Zenobia. When the Muslims conquered the world after the passing away of the Prophet, the first country they invaded was Syria. Damascus became the capital of the Islamic Empire, and since then, in the Islamic history, Damascus remained a very important state, also because all the pilgrims traveled through, or most of the pilgrims traveled through Damascus to the holy places. The different religions have since ancient times been present in Syria. In Syria we know the Via Recta, of the Asher al-Mustaqim, as they call it in Arabic, the Via Recta that has been mentioned in the Gospel. It's the place where Paul walked the streets. Also, Jewish heritage we find with the synagogue of Dura Europos, built in the east of the country, and which was reconstructed in the Museum of Damascus. For the Islamic world, it had a pivotal role, especially in the 11th and 12th century, when the Muslims fought the Crusaders. Crusaders that created their own monarchies, their own states, feudal states, as they did in Europe, in Syria, by which they created the kingdom of Antiochia, Tripolitania, etc. So you also find some heritage of the European crusaders there. And their building styles, for example, in Islamic art, had an impact on the Mamluk building styles through their presence in Syria. In the Ottoman Empire, Syria became a province of an Ottoman Turkish-ruled big empire, and for a long period, from 1517 until the First World War, until 1918, when the Ottoman Empire was defeated and dismantled. During the late Ottoman Empire in the 19th century, Arabic nationalism started against the Turkish influence. An Arabism that was soon to be embraced, especially also by, in Syria and Lebanon, by minority groups. Not exclusively, but you see that Alawites, for example, Christians, embraced the Arabism, later Pan-Arabism, because it is a kind of ideology that surmounts religion, that includes all the citizens. Lebanon is with an E, of course. Important for our story is also that due to pogroms against Christians, this of course Christians, I had written that first in Dutch for another audience, but I did not. Okay, but in 1860 there were pogroms, attacks against Christians in Damascus, but also in Lebanon. And the French urged the Ottoman emperor to create a province that would be ruled by a Christian governor. A Christian governor because the majority of that area, and that's the Jebel Lubnan, that's where Beirut is, and of course all the regions surrounding it, that was by then, of course, in a Christian majority. The French have always hoped for the creation of a Christian state. A Christian state in the Muslim world, if you want, that would be exclusively or almost exclusively Christian. And that was, for example, the dream of Henry Lamens, a Belgian Jesuit father, also a very famous Orientalist in those days, who has written many books on the early Islam, but who in an almost Edward Said-like way was also a person who defended imperialism, that style, and for him the creation of a Christian state was crucial. But that explains why Lebanon became a separate state after the First and Second World Wars, a separate state, but the Syrians later, Hafez al-Assad and Bashar al-Assad, have never accepted, or Bashar changed later, have never accepted the independence of Lebanon, and vouched that Lebanon should return to Syria, that it should belong as a within greater Syria, part of greater Syria. Therefore, there were no diplomatic relationships between the Syria of Hafez al-Assad and Lebanon, for example, in that time. In Syria is divided after World War I between, or the Middle East, between France and Great Britain. Great Britain taking lead over Iraq, Jordan, and Palestine, and the French over Lebanon and Syria. This was due to the so-called Sykes-Picot Treaty. A treaty that was signed in a secret treaty signed during the World War between these two states. They appointed in Syria King Faisal of the Hashimi family, but he was only merely a puppet of the French protectorate in the country. The nationalism grew, Arab nationalism especially, against this time French colonial or protectorate rule. And after the Second World War, Syria gained independence, and this is important, of course, for our talk today. There was a certain ideology that became important in the Middle East. You had, of course, the Pan-Arabism of Nasser, but also the Ba'ath ideology. Ba'ath meaning an Arabic word for Renaissance. Renaissance for the Renaissance of the Arab world, by which these thinkers, Michel Aflaq and Salah ad-Din al-Bitari, defended the idea that you should have a strong Arab world, strong Arab states, ruled by an Arab nationalistic secularist government. On the economic level, it should be a socialist state. It should be have a state-led economy. But within the thought of Michel Aflaq, for example, we find already the authoritarian lines, the authoritarianism that would be reflected in the regimes, for example, of Hafez al-Assad or of Saddam Hussein. Because Michel Aflaq said that there should be, of course, be only one party, the Ba'ath Party, no political pluralism, and that there should be a revolutionary vanguard. A vanguard who defended a more fanaticized group who would defend the revolution or the Ba'ath state. And of course, people like Saddam Hussein and Hafez al-Assad have gone further on especially these ideas at the creation of a one-party state with a strong, centrally led government, with the persecution of all other political movements and parties, socialist economy, five-year plans, typical recepts of socialist authoritarian Arab nationalist state after after the Republic, after World War I. And since its independence and the demise of monarchy, we see in Syria that different republican governments came to the foreground until in 1963 there was a coup d'etat by the army led by this person, Hafez al-Assad. In Hafez al-Assad is a person born in 1930 in the region of Latakia. If I go back to the map, if I have some nearby, okay. Here, this area, oh no, sorry. This area, Latakia, Latakia in Arabic, the place where we find a group of a minority called the Alawis, a kind of Shiite group where he comes from. The Alawites were poor peasants in the Ottoman Empire and in the early modern state who felt themselves marginalized by the Sunnite majority. They found they thought they could not make promotion in the state, in the administration, and therefore, after the Second World War, we find that many of these Alawis go to the military schools because the way they can make promotion is in the military. And that is exactly what Hafez al-Assad would do. He was a brilliant student in the school. He went to the school in Damascus afterwards, school, military academy, school in Cairo, Moscow, the time of the Soviet Union, of course, where he learned some Russian, which enabled him, of course, or which was in his favor for his later deals with the Soviet Union. Hafez al-Assad made use, of course, of his position to make promotion in the army and also to make sure that other people would also climb up in the hierarchy of the army. Not only, because mistakenly it's been said, not only Alawites, but also Sunnites, some Sunnite families. Because very easily the conflict nowadays between in Syria is depicted as a conflict between Alawi minority that's taking the reins of the state or the power in the state, and the Sunnite majority that's being neglected. The situation is more complicated than that. But I do not deny that some of that plays a role, especially in the propaganda from some Sunnites against the regime of Assad, that it's just like that the Alawis have constantly been plotting against the Sunnis. And I know some Syrian Alawites, and they're just as good as against the regime of Assad currently as Sunnites. Now, what is Alawism? Alawism is what some call a post-Islamic sect. Alawism, it of course refers to Ali, who was the son-in-law of the Prophet, the fourth caliph, and to whom the Shiites have a special form of veneration. The Shiites say that through Ali, you have some divine inspiration going through Ali to the descendants of Ali. And for the Shiites, that's very important. But you have different groups of Shiites. Some Shiites, as the Twelvers in Iran, for example, they're called more moderate Shiites. People who say that Ali is important, but Muhammad also, for example. The Alawis, from the Alawis, they say that they give priority to Ali. And they say that Ali is more important than Muhammad. That's one of the basic positions of the Alawis. On the other hand, they are a syncretist sect. What does that mean? That means that they have like different influences, or they combine influences of different religious traditions. For example, they honor some Christian holidays, Eastern, for example, Christmas. They don't go to mosques, but they have their old cult temples, as it were, where they gather together and where they even have like something that looks like Christian mass. I would not say, but it has elements of Christian mass. For example, the ritual consumption of bread and of wine, which would of course be anathema to any other Muslims. The Alawi sect is a very secretive group. That means that the secret doctrine and the most important elements of the doctrine are only given to male persons who are chosen by the elites, by the priests. So it's not a doctrine that is for all people, not for women, only men, and then only those men that have been elected by the highest bodies of the Alawi group. And that's something they share, for example, with the Druze. The Druze, they have something similar. They have also what they call a secret book, a book of religious secrets, which unfortunately has been published by the Sassi, by the French 19th century Orientalist. But so Hafez al-Assad is a member of this group. He comes to power with the Ba'ath Party in 1963, and he strengthens his situation continuously from then on. He makes sure that his people rise up with him in the administration, especially in the army, because he's the commander-in-chief and also the head of the Minister of Defense. He is involved in the war, of course, in 1967, the important war where the Arab states are defeated by Israel, by which Egypt loses the Sinai, by which Syria, the Golan Heights, and Jordan, East Jerusalem. Of course, the Sinai, through the peace deal, will be returned to Egypt. There is still a situation of cold war, if you want, between Syria and Israel. And they never came to a peace conclusion, although sometimes American administrations have tried to bring Syria to get on peace terms with Israel. Assad will be involved also in the civil war in Lebanon. Here you see him on this picture with Rifat al-Assad, his brother, who defected in 1998 from the regime. Now he's an opposition figure that has considerable means, I mean money-wise, because he has his own private television station that from Spain. But he is not very popular with the current opposition forces for reasons we will discuss soon. Hafez al-Assad has himself invited to Lebanon during the civil war, where he plays a major role. He lets himself be invited there between the warring factions, so-called to bring stability to the country, but in reality to have like a grasp on Syria, in the hope to attach Lebanon to Syria, as he always has wanted. He has, under international pressure, he has to turn back from Syria in 1989, but he will return triumphantly 2 years later, as we shall see. But first we return to another episode in history that is very important for what's happening now, during the days of Hafez al-Assad, and which gives also a look on certain ideological elements that are in play. The Muslim Brothers in the beginning of the 80s rise against the regime of Assad, and differently to the Muslim Brothers in Egypt, they don't want to do opposition by peaceful means. The Muslim Brothers take up the arms against the regime. In 1980, and they try to assassinate the President Hafez al-Assad during a visit of the President of Mali. He reacts furiously, and all the inmates of prison that belong to the Muslim Brothers are assassinated in prison. So Hafez al-Assad did not take half means. Said Hawa, he referred in his propaganda against the Syrian state to the medieval scholar Ahmed ibn Taymiyyah, who died in 1328. And Ibn Taymiyyah is considered to be, in a way, the godfather of political Islam, to whom many refer, for example, Al-Qaeda, other groups have and referred to this person, who is very important in other senses also for Sunni Islam. He had written what they called in 1305 fatwa, or a religious rescript against the Nusayris. And the Nusayri is the old name of the Alawis, because they were since a very long time present in Syria, in which he demanded from the Mamluk Sultan that he would physically annihilate all the Alawis. The Alawis who had raised into a revolt because they were too, as peasants, too much taxed by the government. And Ibn Taymiyyah pleaded for their physical elimination. The Mamluk Sultan went a little bit away, along with Ibn Taymiyyah's plea, but he just defeated the Alawis, the Nusayris, and he kept them alive because he needed them for agriculture, for plowing the lands. So the Alawis remained and stayed in Syria. And of course, this text of Ibn Taymiyyah is still nowadays being used by some Sunnite opponents of the more radical Sunni opponents to the regime of Bashar al-Assad, thereby pointing to the fact that the country is led by a heretical sect, by pagans, as it were, by people who are not really Muslims, against whom the Muslims should rise in rebellion. And they do so in the city of Hama, the northern Syria to the south of Aleppo. What is Hafez al-Assad doing? He encircles the city, no one is allowed to go in, certainly not journalists, and a massacre takes place. About 20,000 people, militias but also civilians, are killed. A massacre on an enormous scale that takes place in something of about 2 weeks. To give you figures, Bashar al-Assad or the regime has not reached that yet in almost 2 years. So the father was much more ruthless even than the son. And some shrinks say that plays in the mind also of Bashar al-Assad, who has this enormous admiration for his father as a strong figure, as a strong person. But okay, I'm not a psychologist, I cannot judge that. But he comes back a lot later, and now we are here, to Lebanon, where he invades Lebanon again in 1991. What happened then? Most of you are too young to know, in that year Saddam Hussein invaded Kuwait. As a result, there was a coalition of Gulf states, the Emirates, Saudi Arabia, but also Egypt, and of course the Western states, NATO, against Saddam Hussein. And to everyone's surprise, also Hafez al-Assad joined in to fight a person that he considered to be his arch enemy, Saddam Hussein, in the war. And he succeeded to win the confidence of Western states. Indeed, during the 90s, we see that Bill Clinton, the then American president, tries very often to contact the Syrian authorities to come to a peace deal between Syria and Israel, and he manages almost to do that in 2000, but then Hafez al-Assad died. Another important aspect to have in mind about Syria is that it was an ally of Iran. For some, strategic, also ideological reasons. That is that, of course, when the war started between Iran and Iraq, Iraq was the enemy of Syria, the Iraq of Saddam Hussein. They come both from the same ideological background, Ba'ath, and both claimed to be a Ba'ath state, but they were constantly quarreling with each other for geographic reasons, for example, for the Euphrates River, whatever there might have been playing. But there were no diplomatic relations between the two states. And when the war started between Iran and Iraq, Hafez al-Assad or Syria was the only state to defend Persian-speaking Iran. It was perceived as that in those days, while all the other Arab states, of course, were then supporting the Arabic-speaking Iraq. And so there's it was depicted in some of the Arab countries as Syrian treason. It's treason to the Arab cause. But Iran remained to be an important ally of Syria until today. Now, in 2000, he dies, Hafez al-Assad. He was just working on a possible peace deal with Israel and on the return of the Golan Heights. But everything went off because of the international situation, because of renewed fighting in the Palestinian territories, the Second Intifada, etc. He had two sons. One of them was Basil, and you see him here right on the picture. His other was Bashar. Basil was tipped for by Hafez al-Assad to become his successor. Basil was a military figure. He was climbed up in the military hierarchy. He was a sportsman. You know, he was the president of the Syrian Sports Federation. He was in that way known to the Syrian public as a fighter, as a sportsman, a very male man, tipped, of course, to become the successor. But what happened? He was maybe too much of a sportsman. He died in 1994 in a car accident. And then the father was then, of course, puzzled what to do. His other son, Bashar al-Assad, was in that time, since 1992, studying in London. He was an ophthalmologist, and he was going further in his medical career. And he never hoped to be, or never thought to become, the president of Syria. And he had to return. He had to go through a very quick military training. They made him a colonel in 1999. But he never, he felt himself always very awkward in uniforms. You almost never see him in a uniform. Contrary to his brother Basil, Bashar al-Assad never liked uniforms. You see him sometimes, occasionally, like last weekend. With Bashar al-Assad, the Syrian population had some hope. They hoped that there may be some changes to this brutal dictatorial state of his father. And there was a new wind going through the Arab world in general. You see that in Morocco, for example, the King Hassan II, he was a very brutal ruler in his own mind, of course, was succeeded by Mohammed VI. Mohammed VI, who took some, gave some criticism on his father, which was very appreciated by Moroccans. And afterwards, also in Jordan, you see that King Hussein was followed by Abdullah. The same in Syria. You see that there was like young, new rulers, and the people attached their hope to what may happen under their authority. And Bashar al-Assad indeed promised that there would be some reforms. He released some 400 prisoners, political prisoners. I say that some more than 4,000 remained in prison. He promised more transparency in the state. He also spoke of political pluralism. But the hopes of people were soon dashed, and it came back to the old, with some maybe cosmetic changes, but not real change that took place. So that's the situation before the military situation starts. Important is also what happened in 2005, hey, something that led to a proliferation and to an opposition of two forces in the Middle East, of which they spoke in that time. That's 2005, the assassination of Rafiq al-Hariri, the prime minister in Lebanon, a person who was pro-Saudi, pro-Western, and who towards the end of his premiership gave more and more critique on the Syrian presence in Lebanon. Hey, because Syria had managed to return to Lebanon, especially after their help to the coalition against Saddam Hussein in 1991, by which the Syrian presence was again established in Lebanon. The finger of accusation points to Syria and its satellite, Iran, and Hassan Nasrallah of the Hezbollah, the chairman of the Shiite pro-Iran militia in Lebanon. And two forces come of this, and that's two forces against each other, a pro-Syria, pro-Iran side with Hezbollah, with Hamas at that point, with some other parties in the on the Lebanese landscape, for example, also some Christian groups. And on the other side, we find the Mustaqbal party, the party of Rafiq al-Hariri, now led by his son Saad al-Hariri, other groups, Christian groups, the ancient Falangists, and so on, and in the Arab press, they start to talk from that time on from two camps, the camps of moderation and the camp of revolt, of revolution against either siding with the Western world or against it. And Nasrallah takes a leading role in that, together behind the scenes, of course, with Ahmadinejad, then president of the Iran. The situation has changed now, but we come back to that again. The contrary to the Arab Spring and the revolts that have risen in Egypt, in Tunisia and Libya, we find that most of the revolts have started, originated in the smaller towns. Smaller towns in rural areas like Dera, Idlib, Deir ez-Zor, etc. People, homes, places of which you hear about every day in the press, probably. And these places are more desperate places, places that are not really nice to live in, with a very high unemployment, which points to the economic roots of the revolts. The fact that people, just like in Egypt, revolted because of the economic desperate situation, because they found themselves marginalized compared to the ruling elites. And in fact, although he comes from a socialist background with the regime, if you want, the President Bashar al-Assad said that the state needed economical reform before political reform. So what did he do? Cuts in the budget, subsidized food was cut. All these measures that were very unpopular for especially the poorer population. On the other side, we see that some elites were being protected by the state. The president wanted a kind of privatization of the economy, but only some elites, some people close to the regime, benefited from that and in fact created monopolies. which is not conform, of course, with a normally private economy state. And therefore, in March, the first revolt broke out, the first demonstrations in this place, Dara, close to the borders with Jordan. Also, like in Tunisia, has happened, triggered by one event. And the event was that some schoolboys in a secondary school, high school, painted as some graffiti, some anti-government graffiti on the walls of the school. And they were, it was found out, and they were arrested and beaten up harshly in prison. And that released the anger of the people in Dara, and they came to the street. And once that Dara, that there was a first grand demonstration, the other cities followed suit. Cities that are the same type of cities, smaller cities with a sizable population of young unemployed people and frustrated people. And, more and more people came to the streets in these first demonstrations to be harshly suppressed by the regime. By then. One of the important facts also that you have so many people, unemployed young people in these areas, in these smaller towns in the rural area, is that Syria has known droughts from 2003 on until 2010. So for a long period, a period of drought in the rural areas, by which of course people went more and more to the cities. And through the migration control that also always has existed in Syria since the day of Hafez al-Assad, people cannot go anywhere in the country. For example, it's difficult if you live in Idlib to say, like, now I'm going to relocate and I'm going to live in Damascus, as, for example, people could do in Egypt. And so they had to go to the rural, smaller towns, like this in Deir ez-Zor, for example, mostly quite desperate areas. How did the president react to these first demonstrations? He promised reform. And so he gave a double image, in fact. He said, first of all, okay, I understand your problems, I promise reform. But on the other hand, he said, like, there's an international conspiracy. In the beginning, he did not give names, but later he would. And now, of course, he would say the people who are leading a conspiracy against Syria are the United States, of course, Saudi Arabia, Qatar, other states. The violence went on and became worse in the months that followed after March 2011. And soon the president would send in his tanks, the army, to the areas of demonstration. The Europe and the United States started immediately after the first immeasurate violence against the demonstrators with economic sanctions. The assets of the leading figures in the states were frozen in Europe. Also tried to have an economic ban on Syria, but Assad was by large not impressed and went on with the fighting the demonstrations, also with military violence, which created a situation that more and more the problem became militarized, that weapons came into the country and that people organized themselves militarily against the regime of Assad. By which, by that time, later in 2011, the military men of many soldiers, officers, high-ranking officers in Syria defected to the then established Free Army, the Syrian Free Army. But other opponents of the regime, like Burhan Ghalioun, who was in the beginning a leading figure in this Syrian opposition to the regime, went to Turkey, had a base from there, and pleaded for a peaceful solution of the problem. The Arab League convened and condemned the violence of the Syrian state demanded for moderation and threatened also with the suppression of the membership of Syria in the Arab League. Here you see Nabil El Arabi, the current Secretary of State of the Arab League. The rebels got a face with people, for example, who was on the military level, very important in the early days of the revolt, Riyad al-Assad, who defected with other officers and who organized the military combat from Turkey, by which the relations between Syria and Turkey that were already problematic, of course, became more strained, and it will become worse. By March 2011, by April 2011, you see that already, 2012, a year later, that many, the death toll of in Syria, the people that have died during the fights for the different areas. And you see, of course, differences still by that time between Damascus and between, for example, Deraa, where it started, Hama, Homs, these smaller towns where the violence was especially more intense. The demonstrations will only become large scale in Damascus and Aleppo in a later time. Next to the army, we see that different, or to the free Syrian army, mostly people who have defected from the Syrian army, we find that there are many militias now. There's a Kurdish militia, for example. There are different types. There are probably also Salafist militias. And here, for example, there's something that happened that Bashar al-Assad has created by himself. In fact, after 2003, when there was an American army presence in Iraq, Bashar al-Assad has allowed these radical Sunni militias to operate from Syria and to attack over the border at the American army in Iraq. Now, of course, these people have turned against him. And we see that the reverse is happening, that also militiamen, probably Sunnite militiamen, are coming from Iraq over this 1,200 stretch long kilometer border with Iraq, coming to Syria to fight. The fight has shifted in the last summer and still until now to Aleppo. This is just a picture that shows here the old fortress of Baybars, built in the 13th century, still serving now under the militias, maybe as a military stronghold. You're holding the entrance to this old medieval castle. The regime reacted with more and more brutality and repression to the demonstrators, but not only to the militiamen, but also to the civilians. As civilians were abducted, men, women, children, they were tortured in prison, killed, assassinated. Many people have disappeared. Others, in a token of supreme cynicism, have been returned, mutilated to their families. As many cases have been documented about such brutal and criminal crimes of war perpetrated by the regime, by which they relied on what is called the ghost army or the Shabiha. These kind of men in this picture, they look like henchmen and they act like henchmen, brutally retaliating demonstrations, etc. in Syria. Another one. Yeah, this is a caricature about that Shabiha, here led by Assad. Russia has sent in the summer then the Russian fleet to Tartus, which is in this area. And this is, of course, one of the reasons maybe why Russia and China have been blocking all the UN resolutions against Syria, for their own to protect their own interests. And for Russia, that is very sizable, that is the only military harbor or base they have on the Mediterranean, which is located in Tartus, which dates, of course, back to the days of the Soviet Union, when there was a good cooperation between Syria and the Soviet Union. Diplomatic efforts have led to nothing. We have seen that many diplomats have tried to find peaceful solutions, workable deals between the opposition and the Syrian authorities, but to no avail. And the first effort that was led by Kofi Annan, the former Secretary General of the United Nations, who proposed a plan in 6 points to which the authorities should respond, as, for example, an immediate ceasefire, as, for example, the release of political prisoners, as, for example, a halt to all brutalities against the civilian population. Also, Tayyip Erdogan has tried to come in to find some solution. But as I said, the relationship between Syria and Turkey has by now become very strained. In the summer, the Syrians shot down a Turkish airplane, which led, of course, to more tension between the two states. More and more refugees have crossed the border to Turkey, not only refugees, but also this militiamen of the Syrian Free Army, which made the Syrian army, of course, target them from behind the border on Turkish soil, so that some Turkish villages were attacked on 4 and 5, on last 5 and 4 and 5 October, and Turkey retaliated on Syrian military installations. Of course, there the situation could have become dangerous, because Turkey is a NATO member state. By the NATO treaty, all the members of the NATO are complied to help with military assistance any NATO member state that is being attacked or being involved in a war situation with another state. But I think that from the NATO side on, Turkey is forced to exert maximum restraint in this international conflict. In the summer, many things have happened. The tensions flared up in Aleppo. But there were some other major defections from the regime, for example, by Mustafa Talas. Mustafa Talas was someone who's almost like a youth friend of Bashar al-Assad. He is the son of the person who served as the Minister of Defense under Hafez al-Assad, a very influential political figure in Syria. And he was a friend, advisor almost, of Bashar al-Assad. He has presented himself as a possible key figure for solutions in the future, which is refused by the opposition because they see that he's still too tied to the old regime. Also in the summer, the Free Army and militias had some major victories in assuring the control over some border posts. Had border posts in Turkey and the borders with Turkey and with Iraq, which is, of course, a major blow to the regime. And maybe the regime managed to recapture some of the posts, but some are still in the hands of the opposition forces. Also in the summer of last summer, there were strikes on the headquarters of the security forces where an important meeting was going on of leading figures in the Baath party in the state apparatus. And as a result, 4 were killed. One of them, Asif Shaukat, the brother-in-law of Bashar al-Assad, by which the problem came physically almost close to his own family. In August, Kofi Annan refused to continue his mission, and he was succeeded by another top United Nations diplomat, the Algerian Lakhdar Ibrahimi. Lakhdar Ibrahimi, who's been a diplomat, international diplomat of high reputation, who's very often been used in international interstate conflicts. You see him here on the left on the picture with Zibari, the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Iraq. He started to selenate the area, go around, make his trips to the leader of states of the neighboring countries and also of Syria. But from the beginning on, he stated that his mission was near to impossible, that he would not have any success in the given circumstances to find any workable solution. In the meantime, the news is quite repetitive. You find every day victims, civilian victims also, that amount to now a daily ratio of more or less 100, more than 100 a day. So the situation is still very desperate on the ground in Syria. Especially the town of Aleppo has been targeted, and the revolt has by the meantime gone over to the major cities. That means Damascus and the second city, Aleppo, a city with a population of 2 million, but more than a third of the civilians have left the city by now. The civilians and some of the opponents of the regime have criticized the military militias for using this town as a shield, as it were, against the official Syrian army. But it led to a lot of devastation in Aleppo, among others. Also, some of the older medieval buildings have been destroyed, as, for example, the famous souk of the market of Aleppo, which has gone up in flames. Also, a development of the last months is that the presence of other Arab countries or other Arab countries in Syria is more prominent. For example, Hezbollah. As some people have said, some observers, that probably 1,500 fighters, well-trained fighters who have been in the past fighting against Israel, have joined the Syrian army of Bashar al-Assad against the rebels. Something that was denied by Nasrallah. He said, that's not true. But there were a couple of months, a month and a half ago or something, funerary parades in the Bekaa in Lebanon, area where the Hezbollah is very strong, and where the so-called the martyrs of the movement were buried in funeral processions. Nasrallah said, oh, that's not people who have been fighting in Syria. They have been fighting in the on the borders to protect the Lebanese population from the Syrian rebels. Of course, with some stretch, he tried to give some explanation about what was happening there. But undoubtedly, some of the Hezbollah have been fighting to the sides of the Syrian army. Also, as some say, possibly to protect the routes that they use that go to Iraq to furnish them with arms coming from Iraq, going over Syrian territory, and of course, eventually coming from Iran, over Iraq to Lebanon. But also other fighters have been seen in the area. Some, for example, they say of Saudi, Jordanian, on the Sunnite rebel side. Some say that on the side of Bashar al-Assad also Iranian fighters have been located. So in a way you have a kind of internationalization of these militias. which can, of course, become very dangerous for the future, especially for those who try to have a command or control over these, the free army and the militias. In the body of these people, people of the Syrian National Council, first led by Abdel Basit Saida, a man who's Kurdish, of the Kurdish region in Syria, but especially in a diplomatic effort that has been sponsored a week and a half ago in Qatar, where in the capital Doha, the Syrian opposition forces have gathered, where Hamad Ben Jassim Al-Thani, the emir of Qatar, spoke to this meeting, of course. It's a meeting of different opposition forces, and they try to create what is called the alliance of the Syrian opposition, the Syrian National Alliance, which is just a new body. And yesterday there was a meeting by the Arab League in which some of the Arab states, in front of them the Gulf state, but also some other, accept the National Alliance as the legal representative of Syria. In fact, they created this to have someone to talk to on the international scene. And the Turkish Minister of Foreign Affairs has already urged the international community and said, like, look, you have now a viable body of politicians to talk to negotiate with. Because in the past it was unclear to which you had, with whom you had to talk. But not all the Arab states in the Arab League have accepted that. Algeria, for example, said no, at least no for the moment. Also, Sudan and Iraq had objections to that plan. And of course, Lebanon, because it's so entangled with Syria, has said no to this proposition of creating of giving this alliance the status of the legal representative of Syria. And that's where we are now on the diplomatic level, and we don't know how this is going to develop. I talked this morning to my Syrian colleague, and she said that some people have hopes for this alliance, especially because they have appointed at the top of this body for the moment people who are clean, who are quite unknown for the moment, but who are respectable. Also, from the two top figures, there is one woman, Suheir Atassi, who was, in fact, the granddaughter of the Atassi who ruled Syria before the coup d'etat of the Baas in 1963, and some other figures. Some of the opposition criticize, though, Qatar, for too much meddling into the Syria state, have also meddling in the opposition. And they think that the machinations of Qatar, and to a lesser degree also Turkey with Erdogan, are too prominent. They say that Qatar and Turkey want to fashion a new Syria after what they want, and not really taking for granted the needs of and the demands of other members of the opposition. And indeed, there's one book published by this man, who is a professor in Sciences Po, a political science in Paris, Le Printemps Arabe, Une Manipulation, The Arab Spring, a Manipulation, in which he states, and that's the thesis of this man, is that all of the Arab revolts coming from Tunisia till Yemen and Syria have been manipulated by Qatar. that Qatar has in fact been, I know, is very grotesque, I agree with you, but that's in a way, it is true that, of course, Qatar and other states want their say or want to have their influence in Syria. And that's also why many Syrians say that the problem is imported. I don't agree with that neither. There have been grounds for protest, of course, in the state, and reasonable grounds for protest. But we can maybe agree that the problem became more and more internationalized, and that there is too many players who have interests in Syria and what's going to happen there. And also, on the military level, we can say that we are in a stalemate, as I said in the beginning of my talk, because no one really wants to move. We have seen that in the discussions between Romney and Obama, they said, okay, we're going to arm the Syrian militias, but only those who are trustworthy. How can you judge that from a distance? It's not so very clear. So much depends on what's going to happen. Now maybe there's some breakthrough now that Obama has been elected. It's not to worry about the elections. Much depends, of course, on how these international players, what positions they're going to take, and how flexible, but there's not much hope there, I think, the regime will be. How flexible that Bashar al-Assad is going to be. Because, and that are the words of Abdel Halim Khaddam, who also defected for the regime, but before the problems, long before, I used to be the Minister of Foreign Affairs, I think it was under the authority of Hafez al-Assad. He knows the family of the Assads very well, and it's his conjecture that possibly when worst goes worse, that Hafez al-Bashar al-Assad will refract to the border area, the border of to the sea side, Latakia, Tarsus, where he can still be, of course, supported by the Russian fleet, and hold on to the last breath in that stretch of land. More or less what Mussolini has done with the Republic of Salo, the end of the Second World War. But if it comes to that scenario, of course, I think that's possibly also a bit grotesque. Yeah? But this goes to say that at this time, I think, and I myself not a specialist, I myself not a pundit, but all the pundits agree, we don't know what's going to happen next. And that's where the state where we are at this moment. And now I give the floor to you.